Hello everyone. In this video, I want to go over the example of find the domain of a composite function, in this case f of g of x, where we have two distinct domains, but one for f of x and one for g of x. So in a problem like this, we need to find the composite function of f of g of x, and we also need to take into account, the domains of each individual function. So let's try to break this down and find an efficient method of doing this. Let's first of all rewrite f of g of x, remember, is also written as this. Since the order it's written, f of g, as we can see up here, in that order, that translates to f of g of x written like this, which means that when you evaluate a function like this, you do the inside function first. So that means it's important we consider first the domain of g of x. Since again, if we were to evaluate this, we would have to go through that function first. So it's important that we know the domain of that function. We need to know the domain or the restrictions of it so that we can remain a function. So let's do that first. We'll find the domain of g of x. So I'll isolate my g of x, which again was square root of x plus 4. Now if you recall, in a square root situation, or an even root, we are more concerned with what's inside the radical. And specifically, we want anything that's inside the radical has to be greater than or equal to 0. So I'll set up x plus 4 is greater than or equal to 0. And I'll solve my inequality. In this case, I'll subtract 4. So x is greater than or equal to negative 4 will be my domain. Or if you want interval notation, we'll say negative 4 to positive infinity. So now that we understand the domain of g of x, let's look at the composite function. So we're going to put g of x inside of f of x, which again is up here at x squared plus 1 over x minus 3. So again, here are my two functions. So recall, that means that we put in, for g of x, we put that into the f function, and then we put that into the function f itself. So in other words, I take the square root of x plus 4 and put it into x anywhere I see it in the f function. So in place of x, I'll have, instead of x squared, I'll have the square root of x plus 4 quantity squared plus 1 over the square root of x plus 4 minus 3. When I evaluate, when I square my square root, it'll cancel out, and I'll have x plus 4 plus 1 over. Now the square root of x plus 4 I can't do anything with, so I leave it as so. So I'm left with, after I simplify, x plus 5 over the square root of x plus 4 minus 3. So this is my composite function. Now that I have this, I want to go back to the overall domain. So with the overall domain, I want to look at, of course, the first domain of my inside function, the g, and now I want to consider the domain of my new composite function. So I have the original domain. Now let's look at the domain of my new composite, again, which is right here. So here's my old domain of g. For my new composite function, remember, for domain, I look for a couple things. I look for a variable in the denominator, and I look for radicals. So I have both here. I have a variable in the denominator if I look at the denominator as an overall whole, and I have a radical. So I'm going to do both. So Let's start with the domain as a, or excuse me, the denominator as a whole. Since it has a variable, I'm going to set the denominator equal to 0, and I solve for x. In this case, I'd add 3. So the square root of x plus 4 equals 3. I'll take this, I'll square both sides. So x plus 4 equals 9. And by subtracting 4, I find that x is equal to 5. Now, when we find domains, when you look at domains in this way, we're trying to find the values that you cannot have. So in other words, this means that part of this domain is that we cannot have the value of 5. Because when we have 5, if we would put that back into the function, we would get a 0 in the denominator. We'd have the square root of 9, which is 3, minus 3, so we'd have 0 in the denominator. So recall that this means x is such that x cannot be 5. So that's part of it. The next part is we look at our individual radical. So we've looked at the denominator as a whole. Now we look at the radical itself. And that, our rules for radicals are, again, that we set the radicand, the x plus 4, greater than or equal to 0. And when I solve this, x is greater than or equal to negative 4. That is the other restriction. Now you'll notice that's the same as the domain of g of x, so that works out very nicely. And lastly, what we need to do is combine all these. So we want to combine all these individual parts into one overall domain. So let's list them out here. We have x is greater than or equal to negative 4, and we have x cannot be 5. So one way I like to think of it is if I were to look at a number line, and if I were to put these two on there, we're looking at both of them. So at negative, here's negative 4, and here's 5, let's say. So x can't be 5, so I'll put an open circle over that. And I'm saying it can be negative 4, so I put a closed circle. And now, since everything's bigger than negative 4, I draw a line to the right, skipping 5, of course, and going on to infinity. So if I were to look at this whole domain, basically I'm trying to say, what is the domain shown by the number line? I would say we'd have an interval notation, that is, we'd say from negative 4 to 5, and then I'll combine that union with 5 to infinity. So this would be my overall domain. So with my overall domain, I now have the composite function, which again was x plus 5 over the square root of x plus 4 minus 3, and I have the domain of said function. So overall, the three steps I want to take when I find the domain of a composite function is that first of all I find the domain of the inside function, then I find the domain of f of g of x while finding f of g of x, and then I combine my domains into one overall expression.